Welcome to the Smoking Word.
What's up, everybody? We are back. And before we start, I want to announce some shows. Madball is back, and so is Hardcore. If you haven't heard, now you have. But we got some shows I want to announce. Madball, Death Before Dishonor, and my boys Cruelhand. We're going to be playing Friday, June 25th in Hamden, Connecticut. Saturday, June 25th in Hampton Beach, New Hampshire. Sunday, June 27th in Reading, Pennsylvania at Club Reverb. Listen, I need everybody to go get those tickets if you haven't already. We're going to party. We're going to celebrate. It's time to live. We are amped. We're having fun with the set. We got a lot of old school shit. We're going to have a good time. So make sure you get those tickets and represent, support the clubs and support the bands and all that good shit. I'm coming with merch and all that. So, and also, again, thank you to my patrons. Without you, this does not happen. And all you motherfuckers listening for free, you should thank my patrons too, because they keep the fucking wheels rolling. But and if anybody wants to invest in the show and you want the show to keep going, patreon.com/thesmokingword. That's who you got to fucking check out. You can invest in the show. 4 tiers. We got the cheap bastard tier at $2 and up. I'm joking, but you know what I mean. There's something for everybody to be a part of this. If you want to keep killing time with your boy, you want me to keep killing time, you know how to invest and keep the shit rolling. And we basically investing in the show, getting more beautiful graphics, as you see, and all that other good shit. So you know the deal. Patreon.com/thesmokingword is the spot. And you know the deal. CasaTheRock.com. always sponsors the Smoking Word podcast. So if you want to support the show, that's the spot. CasaTheRock.com. All t-shirts, $21. You support the movement, support me, support yourself, look good, get that gear. You know the deal. You can also follow me at HoyaRock357 on Instagram, and make sure to add the Smoking Word podcast on Instagram. Hit us up, shout us out. You want to talk some shit, you want to threaten us, you want to get threatened back, that's where you hit us. I want to shout out all my patrons again for fucking tuning in. I want to shout out everybody who's been tuning in around the world. I feel the love. All everybody in Germany, Belgium, Canada, South America. Listen, we see, I check our algorithms and all that other shit. I don't just make that rhythm happen. I also check it. You know what I mean? But we feel the love. Keep spreading the word. Keep subscribing and all that good shit. We feel it. And we want, you know, we want to take this shit to the next level. And you know your boy, always trying to keep things fresh and sexy. And I wanted to dedicate this episode to a very important part to our scene. Not just the New York hardcore scene, but the underground hardcore scene, period. This one's dedicated to my straight edge brothers and sisters. So I figured, who better than to get some of my best friends in the music world, in the hardcore world, which is my life. My brother Toby, H2O, Carl from Earth Crisis, and Richie from Wisdom in Chains. Let's set this shit off. You hear me?
Yeah, you hear me?
Yeah, welcome back to the motherfucking Smoking Word podcast, the what edition?
Straight Edge.
Welcome to the Straight Edge edition, Richie.
Am I wrong about that or no? You look like I was wrong when I said that.
No, I'm right about it. I hope you're still on board, because this whole podcast is dedicated to you Straight Edge motherfuckers. That's and motherfuckettes. Right.
That's what we deserve.
What's up?
And a
I'm
lack
glad.
Of respect in the scene for the straight edge.
Everybody,
we deserve that.
That's right. Welcome to the show. Back to the show, my bro, Richie from Wisdom and Chains. Tell everybody what's up.
What's up, everybody? Richie from Wisdom and Chains. Happy to be back on the Smoking Word.
Yeah, yeah. All right. Good, good. I'm glad to have you back. Let's bring in my next brother, my next straight edge brother.
Who is it?
Who we got? The roulette wheel. Yeah, Carl, you hear me?
Wow.
Carlos, I don't hear you. Volume. Technology. Carlos, we don't hear you. Eric. Yeah. As you can see, Carl is still, you know, on. Yo, Eric, what up?
Audio.
There we go. You hear me?
I hear you.
There we go. That's what I love. Earth crisis with an F in the motherfucking building. Well, listen, and well, and you're another returning guest, but it's been a while. Listen, my bro, vegan fuck the vegan patent. That's my new name for you, the vegan patent. Carl from Earth Christ. What up, Carlos? Welcome to the fucking Smoking Word podcast.
Thank you for having me back, my friend. Good to see you.
Oh, hell yeah. This gave me an excuse to hang out with you, motherfucker. I said, what excuse could I make? Straight edge. Fuck it. Okay, let's talk about straight. But how you doing? You good?
I'm good, my friend. How are you?
Good, good. I figured, let me get rich. I said, you know what? On the real, I said, you know, before we go into this, let me get my last fucking, my last vegan, my last straight edge person in the room. Yo, again, let's spin the fucking wheel. Let's see who's up. Yeah, Toby. You hear me, Toby?
I see a little picture of him.
Yo, you hear me, Toby, or what?
Oh, shit, what up?
Bro.
Oh, my God. This is some...
Listen.
What up, Carl?
Listen, Richie, Carlos, listen.
What up, Rich?
Listen.
What's Toby. Up, Richie?
What's up, Carl? What's up,
Toby? Welcome to the welcome back. All of you motherfuckers is a welcome back, but now is a welcome back for this little vegan gangbang thing we're doing over here. Straight edge banger. Let me leave out vegan, but whatever. But hold on, but Toby, what up, bro?
What up, and how are you guys, man? This is fucking awesome.
I know, seriously. Like, I was just about to tell Carl before I said, let me get you all in the room. I said, on the real, I was like, you know, I wanted to talk about, you know, everybody knows how the fuck we got into hardcore and all that bullshit. But I was like, yo, you know what? I wanted to make note on certain things on hardcore, and straight edge will come up a lot in my convos. I didn't want to sound, I kind of felt like I also was coming out sounding like I was a hater or something, or hate against straight edge dudes when I'm not, when you guys know I'm not. But you know, then I was like, I always try to, not nobody pull my card or nothing, but I started feeling like, because I always talk about certain situations about straight edge, how it divided and blah, blah. We'll get into it later. But then I was like, no, straight edge is a part of this fucking scene, like one of the main bricks, you know, like, and I know that. But I also but I also wanted to make light of it through my eyes. You know what I mean?
Right.
And then I also figured who am I going to get fucking, you know, Rat Bones of somebody to talk about straight edge? You know, I got to get some straight edge motherfuckers. But my whole concept was, you know, I couldn't get every spectrum of straight edge, but I said, all right, you know, obviously I said, Carl, you know, we could go back to the, you know, how people saw you, like I was joking, but the patent of fucking, you know, a fucking of vegan straight edge, you know, at one point, you know, you're the militant, the blah, blah, blah.
I've got my flag behind me.
Exactly. Thank you. Exactly. Hold on. The right pat. All right. And then Toby. You know, Toby, not, you know, vegan, not, but vegan. Oh, he was also straight edge, vegetarian, skateboarder. He was more the skater, wild, surf, hardcore, straight edge kind of thing. You know what I mean? And then Richie was vegetarian also, but Richie's a meat eater also. I don't know if he's eating meat at the moment, but I know he was. He's always been straight edge, but I also know he's also been straight edge and eating meat. So I said, you know, people just think straight edge and veganism is the same thing, which they're not. They may be connected.
Yeah.
But I learned that many, many years ago in Salt Lake City, you know, when, you know, I was yelling, I was like, man, I need some weed. But everybody's vegan here. And the guy was like, I got weed. And he was like, I go, but I thought you're vegan. He goes, I am. He goes, you know what I mean? He goes, I don't drink alcohol. I don't do this. I said, yo, I'm down with you vegans. Like, if I was in Germany, I'd be like, you vegans. But no, but my concept was like, I figured I'd get a little, a little variety to just kind of touch base. And, you know, I know all of us are kind of very like-minded, but also, also have our own different opinions. We all definitely are, you know, every direction. That's what's dope about it. You know what I mean?
Sure,
left, right, up, down, You know what I mean? So,
Yo, Hoya, right now on the show, you have three kinds of straight edge guys.
Yeah.
You know, so we all have that in common, and then we have some things that are a little different.
Yes.
So, we're under that umbrella, sure. But, I mean, when you bring up Carl, I mean, that's it goes hand in hand with the veganism, you know, and there's a whole, that's a scene amongst itself, like the XVX. That's a thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I see what you're doing. That's pretty clever the way you did this. And then with Toby, he's the PMA straight edge. And that's a thing onto itself as well.
He's this. He's the exactly. I'm a surf. I'm a skate. I'm going to go to the show. I'm going to hang out with the guy who smokes weed, but I'm straight edge. Not that Carl was, but Carl was like, okay, hold on. Let me burn down this animal factory first. While you go light up, I don't want no part of that, but I'm going to light this place up while I do that. Toby's like, yo, light up. I'm a skateboard while you do that. And then Richie's like, yo, I'm going to go get some cheesesteaks while you do that. Yeah. As a matter of fact, I may have something for you, you know, if it's going to cost you. You know, I don't do all my own supply, but whatever.
Well, yo, Hoya, were you ever straight edge at all in your throughout your time in the scene?
Every night from 11 to about 7 to 8 a.m., I'm fucking vegan, straight.
Toby, I did hear Toby, back in the day.
Toby, come on. That's the Max. You're supposed to give that's Max that face when he's literally.
I heard back in the day you practiced the straight edge thing a little bit.
No, honestly, I never was a straight edge, or I never had the want to do it, but I never thought about it something I get into. It's just something that I always knew people that were into it, and I was like, oh, all right, that's what I never looked in. I don't know. And I was never, I always did something, but I was never a big beer drinker. I was like, when I was a kid, I smoked a cigarette once in a while and then always blazing when I got, and I didn't start blazing until I was 18 years old. So kind of late, you know.
Wow. Hang on one sec.
Go ahead. Hanging.
Eric. This is my guitar player from Apocalypse Tribe.
What's up, Apocalypse Tribe member?
He's been Earth Crisis's sound man for 12 years. He's been all over. And this man right here is living proof that straight edge and weed smokers can be the best of friends right here.
Yeah, let him know. Carlo, you know, forget. And you could thank me because I broke that ground many years ago.
That's true. But,
you really did, Hoya.
No. But exactly like what Richie was saying on the reel, I was like, just the different flavors. Because also, straight edge for my whole existence, I'm not fucking Vinny Stigma old school. I could talk about my era on, which is similar to your guys. Toby's probably a little bit before me, and the rest of us are kind of on the same. But the same thing. Straight edge was always one of the components of the hardcore show.
For sure, yeah.
The straight edge, the punk, the skateboarder, the skinhead, the ska dude, and maybe a couple sprinkled gothic people.
Hopefully some gothic girls.
Like squad. Yes.
Yeah. You know, one of my favorite unitings of hardcore bands ever in the history of our scene is Earth Crisis and Madball. Like when that tour kicked off, I was so fucking psyched because I was the only straight edge vegetarian hanging out with Hoya and all these dudes. I was the only one.
He was.
And then I knew the Earth Crisis guys. And
finally.
When those tour happened, like that, I knew there'd be a fucking family brotherhood forever from those tours. And I knew how much Hoya blazed and how much partying and insanity was going on. And the fact that Earth Crisis, who had this image that people thought that they only fucked with people who were straight edge vegan, did that tour knowing you guys had nothing to do with that, spoke volumes to me from Earth Crisis. And then you guys doing that tour, it warmed my heart. And that became friends forever. And did that, and you guys did that. That made me so happy.
Even when they booked it, I know they were thinking like people didn't expect that, like Madball and Earth Crisis. Because I don't even think we played a show before that. Did we call before that? No, right?
Scott would know.
Yeah, exactly. You don't even remember because I that's what I'm saying. If we did, it was like one maybe, but I don't even think so because I remember being like just knowing the stories, you know, these guys are the fucking, you know, sure, they're the militant. I said, all right, fine. I like that part of their get down. But they were like, I'm like, yeah, but I blaze. So what's going to happen if I blaze? Wait, hold on. Now you got us in a bus. First of all, we're lucky to have a bus in America. So I'm like, that's dope. But they're like, now you're going to split it. Okay, who are we splitting with? All right. these guys that are the opposite of you guys. And we're like, oh, dope. And we don't know each other. I was like, cool, dude.
No, it was the Guilty by Association tour.
Yeah, you know, it was really like, not. But at the end of the day, yeah, it was like, you know, at the end of the day, like everybody, like, you know, that's what I try to do. I was like, I come from the eras, like, it's all about respect. You show, you know, you show love, you give love. It don't matter what you do, what's on the menu. That's my thing. I was like, I was into hardcore before what was on the menu was important.
Yeah, and where else in the 80s or the 90s could you find somebody with a mohawk who liked punk, a graffiti artist wearing a Jordan 4s and a Jordan flight suit, and a skinhead guy and a straight edge Connecticut guy all hanging out at the same time, at the same place, loving the same bands?
Yeah.
Like, that was a magical era of hardcore. And I think it set the tone for the inclusivity that, you know, has continued on through the decades.
Yeah. Yeah. And the thing with me, like, this was the thing with me also why I wanted to do this, not just to fucking, you know, to say, oh, let me do a straight edge thing. I was like, I grew up like, I'd go to the show, the hardcore show. And in that hardcore show, there was, might've been a straight edge band. They might've been the punk band. They might've been the Oi band. Then there was the hip band, the hip young band, but it was all, that was part of the hardcore show. You know what I mean? It was never. Yeah. And then later on, it became something else. It became a straight edge show or a whatever show. But before we even get into that, obviously, we all come from basically three cities that had a big straight edge fucking movement behind it.
Yep.
You know, so like, we'll start Richie. Just, you know, we don't even gotta go into how you got into the music, but straight edge, the first straight edge, where did that come in the fucking, in your picture? Like, oh, what's that all about? And, you know, I think I want to get down with that. Forget the hardcore, the straight edge part of,
you know, right, you off the bat, I was straight edge before I knew what straight edge was. I was just following that path.
Me too.
Yeah, so I was like, I had that vibe, but then I was into Black Sabbath and these weirdo metal bands. And
wait, you're not allowed to listen to Black Sabbath straight.
Yeah, that's the only way.
Be against the law.
That's the only way. And I was like eating that up, but
Sweet Leaf.
Yeah, I loved all of that. You know, like, I loved all of that stuff. I just didn't indulge at all.
Yeah,
and I maybe didn't for bad reasons. You know, because I was paranoid. Never wanted to let anybody get one over on me. And I saw people getting, you know, oh, he's passed out and he got it.
Yeah, that's true.
They got his wallet. They painted his face. They did this. So I was never going to let that happen. So I was straight edge by default. But then linking up in the scene, I hear about straight edge and there is a movement by me, but it's kind of like a more judgmental, exclusive movement. Yeah. And I thought I'd be welcome with open arms into that. And it didn't work out like that, you know, like, the scene that was going on in this area at the time was an elitist kind of vibe.
Ah.
So I was just hanging out with whoever. I remained straight edge, but it was Judge. When I heard Judge, then I related fully. Then I understood, okay, it's the music, yeah, it's the vibe. It was like, just, there, I mean, that's, to me, it's one of the greatest first albums of any hardcore band, like the first album.
To, yeah, me, they made me like straight edge again, because to me, I always, yeah, it was part of my thing, and then I started hating them because the split, because the separation in the scene. I was like, yo, all of a sudden, there's a label. When I heard, oh, you into tough guy hardcore, I knew there's a problem. I was like, no, it's hardcore. It's, you know, it was all hardcore. You know what I mean? I didn't understand it. You know, it was all hardcore to me.
Now, Judge made me embrace it openly, regardless of the guys who were judgmental or not. I didn't give a fuck. I was like,
the message never, I was always down for whatever. I was like, yo, cool. But when Judge did it, I couldn't deny the record, the music. I was like, yo, that shit is hard.
Yeah,
I was like,
great,
now these straight edge motherfuckers got that metal shit. Now, okay, talk that shit. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
you know, it's, you know, the old school shit is cool. But, you know, again, you know, then fast forward, you know, you had to step your shit up. And again,
yeah,
you know, for me personally, I don't know if there would be, you know, an Earth Crisis with that crunch without a Judge, because Judge was the first time I heard. I don't know I know some of your evolution, Carl, but I remember for me, I was like, wow, that's the shit I want to hear my hardcore sound like that. Yeah. Enough, some more crossover. It was like kind of Cro-Mags, best wishes on that tip. And I was like, straight edge bands that I heard down here were not sounding like that.
Yep.
For sure. When, I don't, you know, so. Yeah, what about you, Carlos?
When Judge came out, yeah, that was my favorite for sure. Yeah. And Scott. And it was, you know, so the Judge album influenced us musically and lyrically. And same for Zero Tolerance.
Johnny, shout out to Johnny Chow and fucking Zero Tolerance. Oh, yeah. Eric, Snuggie. Yeah.
I mean, Zero Tolerance, and when they were playing in the, you know, the late 80s, early 90s, they were a flawless hardcore band.
Yeah. They were definitely the a name that always comes back up, especially on this podcast. And I'm glad, because great dudes.
Yeah. And they came out, I think their first band was called New Balance. And I think they were fully Edge at that point. I think the singer was Edge the whole time. But yeah, Zero Tolerance and Zero Tolerance, Face the Panic, and Judge Bringing It Down. I would consider both those masterpieces.
You want to know something? How much of a moron I am? Number one, I never knew they were straight Edge. Number two, Zero Tolerance.
Yeah, it makes sense. It makes sense.
Again, you see, I don't see color. You see what I mean?
That's right, right.
I swear to fucking God, because yes, I believe in God.
You didn't know that until right now?
I swear on God, and I believe in God, you heathen sloth.
So listen, do I. No,
I swear to God, though, for real, on the real, not till you said that. I just thought Zero Tolerance, you know, it sounds like a hardcore name. And and I actually traded demo tapes with them back in the day, Demise demos on the lines at CBGB. Wow. That's why I always had love for them. And then fast forward, they were one of the bands who kept with it. And then Johnny later on doing his thing, and Eric and everybody. So
Demise with a Z. When you look for it, put the Z in there.
Well, yeah, when you look in the Smithsonian and the Hall of Fame, the Rocker Hall of Fame is with the Z.
That's Carl, right.
All right.
Got schooled by Carl from Earth Crisis. You just got schooled by a straight edge man.
You know, if anybody's gonna do it, it's gonna be one of these straight edge motherfuckers here. That's why you were invited. You know what I mean? But listen, all right, Carl, first straight edge, like even if you were living like that, but when you were like, wow, they're calling themselves what I'm living, or I like what they're doing, I'm gonna fly that flag. Where was the first taste of that you get? Was it with a certain band or one of your homeboys from the area? Because to me, everybody in Syracuse was born straight edge.
After a certain point, that's true. A certain point. But originally, and the reason why we, you know, came out as aggressive as we did was because the original, like, early, mid-80s scene in Syracuse was a punk rock scene.
Yeah.
And a lot of those guys were absolutely great guys. They're great musicians. We had some awesome bands like Milton's Disciples, One Death Two.
I remember you were talking about them last time. Yeah,
and we had the Catatonics, who were awesome. And you know, there were some guys that were a little bit older, a little bit younger, but they really did. Some of those people really did have some problems with, and I'm not talking about within the bands, but some of those people definitely had some substance abuse problems. Yeah,
punk rock, no, drug addict, punk rockers. I don't believe it. No way.
And it's like, we were into graffiti and we were into skateboarding. So we're into all this high energy adrenaline type stuff, you know, running from the cops type stuff. And it's like, I don't want anything other than more of this.
Yeah.
So we saw like some bad examples of substance abuse in it within our own families. And then with some of our friends who are a little bit older, and we're like, we're not going that way. We're going to go a different way. So, and then after a certain point, yeah, you're right. It's like we kind of set a tone. And then you had the other bands like Uprise and Green Rage and Solstice and later Black Sheep Squadron and, you know.
Black Sheep Squadron, I never even heard that. That's a hard name.
I never heard of that either. That's a hard name.
A hard name, right?
And Ghost Ship and now Trail of Lies. So, I mean, we've had kind of an unbroken chain for going on 30 years of,
yeah,
different straight edge bands, different straight edge bands.
Definitely in the fucking water there. And Toby, you got it from, because you were by that DC, Maryland area. It's always been lingering around. Like, and that's it's weird because, like you call, it's that punk mix, punk. And then, you know, in New York, and like me and Richie was also the thrash metal mix with the hardcore. And
for sure,
some of the punk, you could decide if you wanted to dabble with the punk instead or the metal shit, you know. We were in the middle of that. Toby, yeah. Where was the first like Straight Edge? What's that? That Straight Edge? Was it a band? Was it a specific band or a specific person?
Yeah, so for me, my brothers got me into skateboarding. And they also got me the punk rock, Ramones, Sex Pistols, all this, you know, all the basics, Clash. And I could skate to all that stuff. But then when I heard I was like 13, my brothers were smoking and drinking. My mom was working three jobs, and my brothers were watching me, sneaking me to shows, which was wonderful. But they were also smoking weed and drinking. And that was kind of, that scared me, you know? And then when I heard Minor Threat, I kind of found that on my own after all the stuff they turned me on to. And then just listening to the lyrics and then hearing the song Straight Edge, I was like, holy shit. It. Like, it's like these guys are like me. I can skate to them. They're super aggressive. And yeah. They're telling me I don't have to fucking drink or smoke to be fucking cool. Sign me up. And then I made a commitment like at 13 years old. I'm like, this is me. I don't need it. And I just never did it after that. And then later on, obviously loving and admiring the New York scene and moving up to New York and live with GB and all that, took it to the vegetarian, vegan, different level, you know?
Okay, no, that's good, because that was my next question. And I'll start with you right there, because that's what I was wondering. What kind of Straight Edge did you start at? Because we just spoke about, there's different kinds of Straight Edge. And I know some guys through their Straight Edge journey, like yourself, sometimes you're vegetarian, then go to vegan or vice versa. Or sometimes you just stay one way, or like Richie, he dabbled in livestock and then he hasn't, you know, whatever you want to, you know, but you know what I mean? So like, okay, what kind of Straight Edge were you when you started? And then, you know, it don't matter where you are now, but what was it that you started as? Were you a vegetarian Straight Edge? Were you just Straight Edge with not drinking and all that? You know what I mean?
I never tried anything my whole life. So even back then, I was just like, I guess this is what I am, because I haven't tried anything and I don't want to. So I guess I am a Straight Edge person.
Yeah, and you were winning. He was like, I'm winning.
Yeah. And then my mom didn't really, she made her like her famous meatloaf. She made like, I never had fish my entire life except for one time, maybe like a fucking fish stick in a microwave. So we wouldn't have lots of meat.
Dope.
So like, and so I didn't like really fuck with it anyway. Then when I'm 18, I moved to New York and I end up living with Jimmy Chunks and all through Queens and end up with GB House. And then, you know, listening to KRS-One and Boogie Down Productions, listening to hip hop and punk. And my philosophy came out in 1988, the same time that GB Start Today came out. I got to sing on that record. I was living with those dudes. I made at that moment at 18, I was like, yo, I ain't fuck with meat anymore. I become vegetarian.
All right. So vegetarian around that time, 80, around when that Gorilla Biscuits. So you were like, okay, that's it, 88. So vegetarian you started with, because I know you being vegetarian then being vegan a long time and then a little bit vegetarian then vegan again for how you've been for a long time. So
vegetarian. Yeah, for me, it just made sense. Like the what attracted me to hardcore was the positive and then making the difference and changing. Like a lot of the other punk rock was like, fuck your parents, anarchy, never mind the Bollocks, all that shit is cute, but I love my mom. My mom raised three boys. I didn't hate my mom. It's easy to say fuck everything. But to me, hardcore was like, yo, this shit sucks. Let's fucking fix it.
Yes.
And that's what attracted me. Like, let's make a change. Like, to quote Youth of Today. Like, let's do something. Yeah. And so, like, let's stop hurting animals. Let's think about the environment, the planet. All that shit just came. It was natural. You know what I mean? Like, and all the bands I was loving and listening to, they were singing about it. And I don't know. It was easy.
And Richie, all right. Obviously, you were living that lifestyle before. But I know you went vegetarian for a long time. I don't know if you're vegetarian right now or what.
I was vegetarian a couple times, off and on. If I feel a certain way, I'll do it for a little while. And if, you know, then I'll go back if I feel a different way. I always feel like the initial change, I feel good. Then it wears off. Then I go back into a different diet. And then that feels good for a while. Then that wears off. Unfortunately, I never did it for any kind of compassion related issues. You know, that's a good thing. You know what I mean?
I know trust me. And he means that. So,
I did it for other reasons, but I respect that. That's like that's a cool thing. And I'll tell you what, one time, the last time we were on a tour, Gorilla Biscuits, H2O, I asked Siv and Toby. And then later on, I text this question late night to Carl once, because they're all known. Vegans and Straight Edge. And I said, if you had a choice and you could only pick one, what would you pick? And Carl's response was incredible.
Wait, so what was the question? Repeat the question was,
if you can only pick one, okay, straight edge or vegan, which would be your choice?
Okay, now first let's start. So what was Toby's answer? So you
remember? I don't remember.
Well, Toby at the time, he picked vegan.
Okay.
Siv actually picked straight edge.
Which Toby, I believe, because I know Toby, Toby could, he likes living through me for certain things. So not that he would do it, but he likes when I do certain things. So I can see him saying, you know what, the animals would still be good, and I could, you know, let that part to, okay.
I could never do any of it. Fuck it, that's the worst question I've ever been asked.
Yeah, but that's the, so I cornered good. Them both. I that's cornered the them both.
And, all right, and what really about, did. And what about Carlos? What's with Carlos? I want to hear this. Because
I don't know if he could duplicate it, but it was an incredible
response. He bobbed and weaved. I know. What was it? I got to hear it. You know what he did? He texts Cochran and a couple other lawyers. He says, what do you think of my answer? Before I forward it to fucking Richie. So all right. So whatever. All right. So
what was Carl's answer?
All right. Yeah. You want
edge here. Carl, what was it? You remember or no?
No, I honestly don't. Listen, I got my phone. I'll look. When did you send me the text?
Listen, you're gonna have to go on my Patreon to get the answer.
That's the hardest fucking question. That's the hardest question, man.
But that is fucking amazing. But okay, what about now, Carl?
Hold on, I could say this. I could say maybe I'm not really edge because I went and saw Eminem, Dr. Dre, and Snoop in an arena with so much breathing. I walked up super dizzy.
Again, that's why. That's why I mean you're better off picking the vegan part than the straight edge part because you're already contaminated by association.
Oh, fuck, man.
No, we saw. Listen, if you were within 10 miles of that arena from the Up in Smoke tour, you were lit. And Carlos, I gave Carl mad hugs. He's been high. He even knows it or not. He don't even know. Too late.
Did you smoke? Were you smoking weed on the Earth Crisis tour bus?
Oh, are you kidding me? Yeah, no, but. This is a true story, everybody. So in the beginning, right away, because I didn't know them, and I'm like, nobody gonna fucking tell me, bah, 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 bah. You know, I'm already fighting with them, and I didn't know them because, you know, we're just hearing, basically, long story short, there was a certain band that said, yo, those guys are gonna be like that. Yo, like they kind of were throwing fire, what do you call it, gas.
Who was it? I want a name.
Snapcase. I won't say Snapcase.
It was Snapcase?
Yeah, yes. And anyway, I won't say no name, Snapcase.
But it was a singer, wasn't it?
To be honest with you, I don't remember because I don't really know them like that. But I remember them kind of like, yo. And then I want to say...
Him and Dennis were probably fighting.
Listen, you know what's funny? Because I want to say... At the time in your camp, after we became friends, we had kind of heard like, yeah, they were kind of feeling, you know, throwing things around, kind of like, oh, you guys are going to get beat up or they're going to flare, like, you know, kind of that shit. Well, anyway, long story short, I was like, whatever. But also, you know, I also know, you know, we're lucky to have a bus. We never had a bus and that kind of shit. And all right, where it's, you know, we're label mates or whatever. And, you know, same management. I was like, all right, whatever. Let's be cool. And then right off the grip, we got along. And I'm like, no, what am I going to do? I go, these niggas are cool. What am I going to do? Light up now? I know they don't like it. What's up? What am I going to do? Fucking light up? I go, nah, they're cool. All right, let me go out.
And so they never said, up on a bus on,
they never said, no, hold on, let me finish.
All right.
They never said nothing to me. So to me, to be an ass, so if somebody said, because this happened in the past where a band right away, before I even do it, says, yo, you can't do this. The minute you do that, I'll roll a blunt and light it right in your face. The minute you tell me not to. Because number one, I'm not built like that. But that you assume that, now I give it to you times 10. Right? So right off the grip, we got along. And I'm like, oh, well, yeah, they're cool. And I was like, let me go out back. Obviously, it was a 50-50. We're sharing the thing or whatever. We got along fine. And I was like, all right, look at Freddie don't smoke. He never liked smoke. I always blaze. Me and him come as a joint package. Yeah. But we always had a heaven and hell, we call it. The back was always hell and the front was heaven. So it worked out. Like if I smoked, and there was never really cigarette smoke, it was just herb, and that was in the back if there was, and the front was always clear. And it worked out. Everybody respected. Even then, you know, I had love for these guys. So whenever I had the chance to go out, I'd be like, yo, I'll go out.
You know what, though? I do think that we were friends before that tour.
Yes, but if I feel like not as, obviously, we were living with each other. So it
felt
like,
true.
Like it felt a little bit more like, I don't know. I felt like,
yeah, if you do a 7-week tour, yeah. with a band and you're living on the same bus. It's like you lived in the same house.
Yeah, yeah.
By know, the end of it, it's like you were roommates. That's like, absolutely true.
Like, we were probably cool, but it was still like, you know.
We were new to each other, yeah.
Yeah, we, you know, we have a show together. We're backstage together for an hour together and, like, still kind of feeling each other out. Like, you know.
But here's the thing for us. Like, if you... You know, if you met us or saw us when we were like 17, 18, 19, 20, you wouldn't be like, oh, those guys are hardcore guys. Or those guys are punk guys or metal guys. You'd be like, oh, those kids are skaters.
Yeah.
So yeah. we were surrounded by dudes that were heavy drinkers yeah. and were smoking tons of weed. So that was all normalcy to us. That was just not what we were into.
Now, okay, and again, the straight edge I knew was that same straight edge. Like what Toby is, we grew up with a mix of everybody. There was a yeah. Krishna, a punk rock guy, a white power guy. You know, there was always the degenerates all in one spot.
Right.
You know, the artist, the rich kid, the poor kid, the druggie, there was always that. So I already was with that. But then Earth Crisis comes out and they're like, no, this is a different breed of animal. These guys are, like I said, these guys are on some militant shit. I'm like, oh, okay. So, oh, they turn up. I heard stories about this and that. So I'm like, oh, you know, these guys got some squabbles to them. Maybe they might, you know, take offense to my leisure activities. You know? So, you know, it was one of those. But then, you know, that shit lasted I don't even remember exactly. I don't even remember it being like that moment when it wasn't cool. You know what I mean? So that shit probably lasted a minute.
Yo, I remember that tour because I was like, for some reason, like proud when I saw the flyer of Madball playing with Earth Crisis.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, it was just like a merging of the shit that I love that I normally wouldn't think it would, you know, before yeah, that.
I agree.
A lot of people, I was psyched on it because people didn't want it to work.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like people expect like, oh, they're the two militant people of their world, the tough guy band. Oh, they're not supposed to get along and whatever. But all right. Now, let me ask you this, though. This is the one thing with the straight edge shit that was always a hard thing for me to swallow. Uh-oh. And it ain't a main part of straight edge, but it was to the real straight edge, to the Ian McKay's, me and K's or whatever. You're
talking right now to the real straight edge.
So I know I got. Oh yeah. By the way, Richie claimed the original. What was it? No. Anyway, listen. Okay, go ahead. All right. The no sex part right away. That was a no go for the kid right here. You know, that was even if I wasn't getting ass at the time, I was like, whoa, you want me to not get something I want? And that was too much restraint, too much. What was the like in the song? Too no restraints.
But his thing was though when. You know what Minor Threat said that he was talking about not being promiscuous. He exactly. wasn't saying he wasn't going to hang out with his lady and have fun.
You interpreted it. Or
I mean, the dude, really here's meant. The thing. The dude married a riot girl. He's definitely having fun.
Listen, and shout out to Ian McKay on the Smoking Word podcast.
And he has kids, I've heard. So he's probably having more fun than anybody else.
Now, even with that part, that was the part for me but I also knew it wasn't everybody. That's why I always bugged out with straight edge. Like, wow, there's different styles. There's that, like the diehard with that. I used to be like, wow, this is fucking crazy. Like, wow, that's like a real monk taking the monk.
You know what?
Kind of way, right?
In straight edge right now, there's an aspect of straight edge. It seems more of a West Coast thing where it's really porn. It revolves around porn. It's like straight edge porn people.
Really?
All over. Yeah, yeah.
Wait.
Very weird to me. I don't like it.
Hold on. What am I missing?
You guys never noticed this? It seems like.
You hear Toby? He's like, no, not me. Not me. That
no, not, I'm not talking about Toby.
Moon's behind the camera. Toby goes, hell no. I don't know. What are you talking about?
Is that real?
That's real.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Thank you.
Toby's googling that shit right
now. I'm seeing that shit a lot, and I don't like it.
No, I'm not. Fool. You guys are crazy.
Keep your
straight edge porn freaks, sex addicts.
But you know what? All jokes
real
aside,
shit. It's real shit.
I'm not surprised because now it's just what mishmash of subcultures we can put together and try to be like it don't matter. It ain't even like.
But that's part of it. I'm serious. That's a thing. Then there's like we talked about the vegan straight edge crossover. That's its own thing. Yeah. But
people always thought the XXX DC was porn, right? People yeah. always thought that.
Oh, oh yeah, yeah, I guess. Right. I never, yeah, I guess. So all I never right. even, I never thought. I always just, let me ask you this. All right, with the whole strategy, and I'll start with Carlos. No drugs, drinking ever, even trying it, tasting it, nothing, cigarette, anything?
No.
Not none of them.
And here's the thing. At my parents' church, communion was yeah. with white grape juice instead of wine.
Oh, why?
But I love that. But
yeah. in all reality, wine is grape juice. Just left out of
No, I know. But I mean, they had the red and the white. So if somebody, you know, it was clearly for like all the old Norwegian German guys, you know, to not who had a problem with alcohol to not have to have it, you know. But yeah, as a kid, I would just drink the grape juice. And then I always did.
Carl, you never did anything?
Hold up. Yeah, Carl says nothing.
No. I love this. No. See, to me, straight edge is birth till death. That's what it is. Listen, so you got three guys on here, authentic, think, yeah, true OG straight edge.
I think
not
so.
Fly by nights, not I'm in recovery, so I got straight edge.
I'm in recovery. Toby, I know Toby's as it, but Toby, nothing. Too. Nothing.
A toast. NyQuil the most, Carl, baby. Toby. Right?
Nothing. Yeah, Toby. Yo, right.
Toast, Richie. Yeah, you toast. Got
yeah. Like, oh, shit. Yeah, let me tell you,
liquid
this death. May not be vegan, but this shit is banging, motherfucker.
Get that out of here. What happened? You disappeared. What's going on?
I know. My this shit, boom.
Chocolate? I like
Yeah, this shit is Brookside, dark chocolate covered blueberries. Let me tell you.
That's good.
I'll pay for it. I don't even want it for free. I'll pay for it.
You know, Hoya, well, you look great. Has any of your new regimen of working out or diet, anything have any kind of vegan elements to it or no?
Yes. It's not, I don't, like I said, I was, some days I'm vegan and not as a joke, but like some days, even with meat, I don't eat red meat anymore. I eat chicken breast and fish. And then some days I'll just do vegetables, which it's basically a vegan meal. I may not skim through everything I eat, but I'll just eat like, you know, roasted vegetables and fucking, you know, some type of something, but I mix it in, and that definitely, you know, it helps. It definitely helped me with my whole routine working out. And
you look incredible.
Thank you. And incredible. Still, but I definitely, you know, I tell anybody out there, I was like, you know, people automatically assume they try to jump into a lifestyle overnight. And I was like, that's the first mistake. You know, nothing you learn overnight. You know, you get your feet wet. And that's how you start. You know, you learn because you got to remember this. Not everybody's gifted to come from a world where we have the towels, you know, the Tobys or people like that know this or been around with the food game for 100 years. And you know, every restaurant for 20 years, you know, whatever it is. Not everybody knows that.
Yeah.
True. You know, so they got to be schooled. And then that's where I get into beef sometimes with some people that are shit on people for trying. And I'm like, yo, you want this guy to become a fucking vegan one day?
Word.
Stop shitting on him for fucking taking a baby step and not diving in. You know what happens when you dive in? You fuck up.
Yeah, you got to be encouraging. And you know what? It was very noticeable when we saw the Madball Bloodlet or Blood Clot show from New York in the park. That was awesome. So cheers to you guys for that.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, everybody looked like they've been just living in a gym. It was incredible.
Yeah, no, you know, I had... You know, the routine, we got to get our shit together. But again, Adam Blake, you know, I talk about him all the time. My secret weapon, I call him.
Yeah.
You know, again, like I tell people, you know, you reach out, you'd be surprised who's out there. And, you know, if I had a question on something, I would hit up Adam Blake. You know, he works out here. If anybody needs a fucking trainer, hire him. Even if he's not for hire, pay him. But he knows, like, basically, again, I would say, listen, all right, I'm trying to clean up. What could I do? Like, you know, I want to get off meat. You know, what's a protein diet? He'll give me a quick rundown or, you know, what could I do to add to my diet? You know, you know, he was realistic, not trying to give me a vegan diet. He'd be like, okay, what are you eating? You know, kind of thing. And then, okay, try to do this, this and that, which was great.
What was the biggest inspiration or reason for making this drastic, which I think is one of the most positive changes any of our friends made during the pandemic? That I know personally, that's been my friend for over 20 years. Like, you turn your whole shit around and you look incredible. So what made that happen?
No, it was just, you know, my mom's passed away, but not from COVID, but right in the beginning of COVID. You know, I've talked about it in the past, but long story short, you guys know I'm a single father, and my mother was basically raising my oldest son. you know, since he's been 1.5. So, you know, in the back of my head, you know, I always had that in the, you know, there was always in the back of my, when, you know, one day my mother's going to pass away. Okay. Try not to think about it. But there it happened. She was fighting cancer. So we kind of saw where it was coming. So basically I knew it was crunch time. Now I know, you know, that was my last line of defense, you know, was my mom's. Now it's just me. You know, of course my father's here and I got a brother, he helps, but you know what I mean? Like as far as a mother, father kind of thing. Yeah. I said, now he just got one. It's just me. And I told myself, I'm going to do whatever I could do in my own, reach to stay alive as long as possible. And I said, the things that I got control of is what I eat and, you know, and how much, you know, what I do to extend my life. Right. And for my son, all it took was that. I was like, you kidding me? I said, I thought of my son being a fucking, an orphan.
Right.
And
damn, man.
And that alone, I swore now while I'm alive, God takes me when he's ready to take me. But I'm not going to give him a head start because I want to eat a fucking Big Mac.
Right.
So,
right.
So I just said, fuck that. And I don't look back and I'm good. You know, I'm fine with, you know, how I'm now. I'm, you know, like, again, I know I got extra years of my life. That means I get my sons for a couple extra years. And that's enough.
That's beautiful.
It's so good. I'm so sorry for lost your mom. I met your mom many times. She was an amazing woman. And I'm so fucking proud of you, man. Like,
now,
so
you know, and I know all you guys, and I'm glad all you guys, I feel, you know, everybody's been good, you know, fucking showing mad love. And I'm glad. And I go figure. My mom's gave me fucking superpowers from the other side. You know, she did that while she was passing. That was like, you know, even at the worst time, I did something that I could have, you know, I didn't do in fucking 40 plus years. You know, not just because I needed to. I thought of my mother, what she would want of me. She'd be like, yo, you got to do this shit for your boys. And and I'm a mama's boy. You know? So that means I got to make mama proud. So while I'm on this earth, I'm for my boys and all about fucking life. Beautiful. But definitely the vegan, I brought it into my lifestyle here and then. And I advise anybody who's thinking about it, you don't got to dive into it. But you could fucking baby step into it. And then, you know, you never know. I definitely got a lot more. I never had hate for it, but I got a lot more love for it because there's a lot more variety of foods available now.
100%. Sure. Yeah. Yeah. It's way easier than it's ever been.
Yeah.
Way
you know, easier. Yeah. You know, and that's the shit. So I tell everybody, hey, go for it. You know, I say, hey, try it. Oh, because, you know, people, when they do anything too gung ho in one day, you know, you can't do nothing in one day. You learn what you work with. You learn, you know, the right thing. See, because you could also be a bad vegan. We all know that. You could be a bad straight.
Like me. I'm a bad vegan.
That's why I love you. You're a bad one. You're one of them bad ones.
I love when people like do meatless Mondays or try this. Like,
yeah.
I love that, dude. People just trying, man. You know,
I do it with my sons. I don't make my sons not do this, but I tell them, I said, hey, look it. You know, you want to eat that? Because I hear my son sometimes. Oh, look at the poor little pig. I said, yeah, but you eat bacon, right? And I remind them. And, oh, yeah, but that's different. I go, no, it ain't different, dude. That's what it is. I remind them because it's true. You know, I'm like, don't forget what it is. I don't never want to be fake also. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you know, like,
yeah.
You know, I'm not.
You got like a physical and checkup since you lost all the weight?
And. I hate talking about it because it's one of those.
I'm asking. This is so inspirational.
No, I know. I don't want to because of that. But thank God again, because I believe in God, you heathen sloths out there. I know Carl loves that. But I got two physicals since, you know, this whole last year to check. And from the first to the second, the doctor goes, I don't know what you're doing, but yo, I was diabetic before. I beat all that shit before. Besides that, she's like, yo, I don't know. I don't know what the fuck you doing, but keep doing it. And she's like, all my everything, you know,
cholesterol, blood pressure, all that.
I don't take nothing. No high blood pressure. No, nothing. I thought I had sleep apnea. At least I took a test. I don't even got that. I was like, you don't understand. And I swore to God again. I believe in God, you heathen sloths out there. But I said no. But I swore at one point. I thought I was fucked up. You know, when all that was happening, I had an anxiety attack. I was like, I'm gonna die. I'm gonna leave my son fucking or fame, yeah, and because I, you know, my health, whatever. And I, you know, I started thinking, so I was like thinking the worst, but you know, thank God I started training. I changed my whole shit around, and I swore to God, I said, God, give me a chance and watch me rock this shit. I said, give me a chance for my sons, and I rock the shit. I said it just like that. And the minute the doctor said, listen, you know, you don't got diabetes and your kidneys aren't fucked up. You got arthritis in your back a little bit. That's what they told me. I said, it's on. I started doing push-ups. I fucking went vegan for a couple of months, vegetarian, and all types of stuff, crazy shit.
Doing great. You just, God is going to be very happy once you stop with the weed, and then you're going to be good.
Listen, God invented it, dude, the burning bush.
He invented poison ivy, too.
You motherfuckers eat it. You motherfuckers eat it. I'm blazing. You fucking got to take all the fun.
How did it feel being on stage, putting a bass on and playing as far as energies wise and moving around on stage first time?
To be honest with you, I couldn't really tell because just being trying to remember the songs was more like, I was still more on that tip more than thinking like how I felt. But what I could tell mainly is on my clothes. You know, that's where I'm like, oh, shit, because I wear extra large now on the shirt, you know, like.
I used to make you custom 5X shirts.
I know, 5.
I used to send you 5X H2O shirts.
I know. That's why I always rocked. H2O was the first band to make me shirts my size. That's why I always had probably early H2O shirts.
Fuck, man. Now you're 2X.
That's no, yeah, I'm 1X now. Yeah, get it.
That's amazing.
Yeah, us three are 1X too as well.
Yeah, no, but I'm a 2. I'm a 1X, then you wash it, then I'm a no X. Then I got to go up 2Xs. So I'm still fronting as a 1X.
Holy shit.
But
it's incredible. It's super inspiring, man.
Oh, but like, the one thing I want to say, ask about this while I got you guys, because this is something that I always brought up, and this was important with the whole straight edge shit. So, you know, and where you think, if you think anything, all right, like I said, I grew up with straight edge being a part of everyday hardcore, right? It was like we said, it was a skinhead, the Krishna, the straight edge kid, whatever. And then at one point, it started separating. And I have my theories on why it's separated, and people may have heard it, where, you know, in my opinion, certain bands excluded themselves and made, you know, they probably, even if they didn't do it consciously, but them giving that movement a label separated themselves just from being a hardcore band. You know, if you want to call it youth crew or whatever specific band, you know, I got theories on if certain bands that maybe were involved with it, that again, if they didn't do it specifically, their following did, and then excluded themselves and separated straight edge from regular hardcore, and then it became straight edge hardcore, and then whatever hardcore. I know you guys felt that from when we first came up, because it definitely changed, and I know we all come from an era where it definitely divided. Do you have any theories on it, or you just think that was a natural evolution that was going to happen, that it was just going to happen, not because of a certain band or movement? It was just going to naturally happen.
I mean, I don't know if it was something that occurred organically. I know that we definitely didn't stray from New York hardcore. We played with everybody. We played with metal bands and punk bands and everyone from, you know, Brooklyn and Queens and Lower East Side. Like those were predominantly the bands that we toured with.
Yeah.
I mean, we, over all these years, there's very few. I mean, we played shows with other straight edge bands, but I mean, tours were very few and far between with other straight edge bands.
And you see also with you, it's also maybe for you a little different even than Toby and Richie from your area. So your area was kind of special also from like how we mixed and how you guys mixed. I'm still New York. But you also had a different thrash mix with it. And it's also different connections to different parts, like the Ohio's, you know, the like different areas that had different vibes. So it brought different vibes to your scene. And
for sure. Yeah.
And also in the layout, we all grew up with the youth of today's, the Gorilla Biscuits and all that. But maybe in our scenes up there, you had your own other bands leading those movements. Right. So like, let's say Toby, like, we kind of coming in, also Richie, like the bands that where we were at was, it was the youth of today's, the Gorilla GB. Biscuits. Yeah. They were probably the front guys.
Judge.
And, you know, yeah. And Judge, obviously, or whatever, you know, and I'll say my theory just to refresh and to finish off the other two guys. So you can know what I'm talking about a little bit more or less. I always felt, you know, it came with Youth of Today, which I loved early Youth of Today. But the whole thing was, I remember all of a sudden it becoming, oh, there's straight edge shows. I remember Liz hearing that title. Oh, there's a straight edge show going on. Maybe that title went on before me, but my existence early on, I never heard it. And then one time I heard it and I was like, what do you mean a straight edge show? And they're like, oh, you know, it's a youth crew show or something. And I go, oh, you mean only youth crews allowed? I'm like, then the fuck youth crew. No, but you know what I mean? What's the first thing you're going to tell a kid? Oh, it's you're excluding. And I never forget that, because I'm like, wait a minute. Because guess who was at all the Youth of Today shows? Guess who was at the Gorilla Biscuit shows? Who was at all the Instead shows? Guess who was at all the No For An Answer shows? It wasn't just straight edge motherfuckers. It was all of us.
Right. Yeah. And we were the guys up in Syracuse that would see Sick of It All and Agnostic Front and Cro-Mags. You know, it's like, there was no desire to separate from hardcore, but there was a desire to have like a mark of distinction when it came to vegan strategy. Okay, this isn't something that is we're going to toy with. This is something that we're going to live true to. You know what I mean? So that was our goal, because a lot of those earlier bands, you know, they were straight edge for 3-4 years. Maybe they lasted 5-7 years tops. But then they, you know, for the most part, most of those bands didn't stay involved.
Yeah.
And they didn't stay straight edge. Yeah. So we were like, okay, well, we're going to do our own version of it. And we're going to have kind of a clear definition. But then again, we were out there touring with Bloodlad and everybody else. You know what I mean? And Damnation and you guys.
Yeah. No, later we learned that. That's why I said, man, Syracuse, that area has its own different way it ticked, which is dope, which I learned later on in life, how you guys ticked and all that shit. Richie, then Toby. But Richie, we've talked about this, and you know where I'm coming from with this. What do you think of my theory? And I don't know if you agree, or do you see it in any other way, or you have any theories on it? Because I definitely saw a split, and that bothered me. Again, that's why I wanted to do this, not just because you guys are my boys. I wanted to show love that, you know, also straight edge is one of these bricks that fucking this thing is built on.
It's
very important to be talked about. But I also, you know, like anything great, there's always the little soapbox drama that, you know, that's why we're here to talk about. And this is shit that we've all kind of talked about behind the scenes, you know.
Exactly what you're talking about. And with it was bands like Youth of Today that I just never liked them. You know, right off the bat, I felt like, okay, this is for certain people. And if it's for certain people, I don't want to be there. That I could be wrong. I don't know those people personally, but I felt like, okay, they're not being inclusive. I never had that feeling about a straight edge band like Earth Crisis. I never had that feeling about a straight edge band like H2O. You know what I mean? Yeah. But for Youth of Today and some bands from that era, I didn't like them at all. I didn't like the idea of it. And I always liked, you know, there were scenes where, you know, 90% of the kids in one area are straight edge. And that's cool. But that just wasn't my area.
Yeah.
So I was like, it's easy to be straight edge when that's the cool thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
If everybody's straight edge, mine as well. But when you go to a spot, probably like the Lower East Side, and you see, oh, out of all of these people, you got only like 3 straight edge heads here. Those are real straight edge motherfuckers that are probably still straight. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I always notice that stuff. But I didn't like the vibe, like I said off the bat. And I you know, locally in PA, there was a lot of bands that were very exclusive. And they would look, I'll be honest, they would look down on a band like Madball.
Yeah, of course.
You know,
yeah.
And it would blow my mind. Like, what do you mean? You're looking down an Agnostic Front and Madball? Like, who the fuck are you to do that? Like, that's crazy to me. But there was that vibe for a while. And, you know, surely enough, that whole straight edge scene depleted. Like Carl said, a lot of those bands did a handful of a couple demos or a couple years, even the bands who were the cream of the crop at the time. And of course they stopped being straight edge, you know, so many. But I never liked bands that had like that vibe to them. You know what I mean?
I did Break Down the Walls. That was my joint. That's a great song, right?
I liked the lyrics of that song.
No, I liked a couple of the songs. And you know what? And they had their shows were mad energetic. So I used to love straight edge shows because they were like, oh, stage diving. You knew off the grip. Yeah. You know, I loved Gorilla Biscuits. I said, oh, Gorilla Biscuits, one is going to be packed. you know, and everybody's be stage diving. You know, even you, to any straight edge show,
with
you
know, GB, I felt a different vibe with GB because the front man was a different style of front man than the Youth of Today type guys.
And you know what's funny? I mean, with Youth of Today, it was, we all went to Youth of Today shows, and it was not maybe nothing specifically they said. It was what their kind of crowd said, and then kind of they went with that way. You know, kind of they kept, so since they were the loudest and their crowd was rocking that way, I said, all right, then fuck you, you know, then. You're to blame. You know what I mean? You're the face of it.
I got that vibe too as a straight edge guy. Just because to me, hardcore first, hardcore for hardcore, hardcore first.
And then we had the Gorilla Biscuits in our neighborhood. So again, people used to try to be like, you guys are just meat heads. I'm like, Gorilla Biscuit House was in our neighborhood where we used to hang out. The park where we were, fucking Civ lived there. Gus Stratus, Toby lived there.
Jackson Heights.
You know. Yeah. Real, you know, straight edge motherfuckers. Yeah. And I was like, it wasn't like, oh, we can't be cool with the guys because they fucking don't want to eat fucking spaghetti and meatballs.
Let me tell you about Civ. When I asked Civ about straight edge, he said, I'm still straight edge because I'm not going to let anybody talk shit and call me a sellout. And when he said that, I love that shit. Like, that's a crazy person to talk things like that, right? Like, they will guide their life a certain way because they said something, and they're going to stick to it, and I'm not going to let somebody else talk shit. You know what I mean? So he's kind of saying it's not super important to him like it once was, but it's important enough to make sure nobody's going to talk any shit. You know what I mean? I like that.
And Toby, I know you felt it, even if you didn't feel it was a ban or something, but I know you felt it because you come from that era where even you, like you said, you were the only straight edge dude hanging out with us.
Yeah. So, and I love that. So to go back to two things. One, Carl, how you guys always play with diverse bands. I think your guys was your message. You want to get your message to the masses.
Yeah,
any way you
smart.
Could, any kind of crowd. You didn't just want to preach to the converted, just only play to that type of crowd because those kids already loved you and believed you and they already were straight edge vegans. So I love the fact that Earth Crisis did play with Madball and try to get their message to different crowds. And so, yeah, I love Youth of Today. I love Youth of Today. I saw them play. I love their music. They inspire me. But at the same time, I was hanging out with Hoya and Isaac and Freddie and all these dudes and the Token Entry dudes and Anthony Killingtime who wasn't straight edge. And I was accepted into this New York family. It was a dysfunctional family, and not every single one of them was straight edge. It was all different walks of life, and that's what attracted me to hardcore and punk. We weren't all exactly the same.
Yeah.
We all thought the same and agreed on so many things about fixing this fucked up world. But Hoy was smoking a blunt next to me, or Freddie had a 40-ounce, and I was carrying the boombox on fucking St. Mark's, and I was the only straight edge guy. And I fucking loved that, and I love my friends for who they were, not because they drank or smoked or didn't eat meat. I didn't give a fuck.
Yeah.
And so like I never. All that stuff is cool. I love the movement. I love that so many kids were inspired to not drink or smoke or do drugs from this music that we're so lucky to be a part of. I love that. But I never judged anyone. I gave a fuck if you were or you weren't. And to me, it was my personal choice. And that's what I got my whole life. Like, my fucking wife's not even straight. I'm married to 25 fucking years. All my friends were like, so me, like, I just loved. I loved it for me, and I love the movement. I loved all the, loved all those bands, and they were changing the world and affected so many people's lives. But I loved my friends, and I think it'd be so boring if all my friends were all exactly the same, and all we talked about was like what fucking tofu we tried today, you know what I'm saying? Like, I love the diversity of all my friends, and I think that's what made me who I fucking am, and that's who molded me by moving to New York.
Yeah, and that's why I always use Toby for an example, and also Carl, because they're the more extreme. You know, with Richie's in the between, it's kind of like, oh, Richie's a meathead, you guys are meathead. It's kind of more normal. You know, where you guys, they bug out with Carl or whatever, but I'm like, I try to do it also to show on both sides. Look at meatheads, you know, it's already old with the whole, oh, with the vegan shit. And then it's also with the vegan dudes. Don't be scared. Not every meathead wants to kill you because of your fucking what's on the menu. You know, it goes both ways. I want to show that a lot of people don't give a fuck. You know what I mean? And again, my first, when I did later on, I went in to get into trying to change my diet. I went on. Oh, I remember this guy eating that. I remember this. And look, it came into play. You know what I mean? My friends coming into, and I tell stories, man. I tell stories about you guys all the time, how rough it was for you guys to eat back in the day. And I go, wow.
Totally.
But you know, I'm like, wow, I can't eat better every other day when these guys had to drink fucking this, that. You know, I use that shit to get me over on days sometimes. You know, I'm like,
go ahead. I'll say none of you guys ever broke my balls for being vegetarian or straight.
Yeah.
Nothing. You never gave a fuck. We had so much fun together.
Yeah, was that important. Like I said, the menu was never that important. Later on, it became, and then, you know, meatheads ran with it, and then the straight edge, you know, elitists ran with it, like, oh, you know, it's the meatheads, and the meatheads, like, fuck the straight edge. And it really became that when it was like, it wasn't. But again, that's why I wanted to bring this together for peace, love, unity,
and fuck. Hoya, I love the dudes who be smoking weed and drinking, and straight edge kids be stage diving at a Murphy's Law show.
The best.
I love that.
I fucking love that to death. Yo,
it brought us all together.
We used to play Syracuse. We get mad love from the straight edge. Salt Lake City, vegan motherfuckers going nuts. Machine Gun X's, you know, going insane for Madball. Listen, I got mad love for that. Again,
let me ask you a question.
Ask.
What is a more intense straight edge scene? Syracuse or Salt Lake City?
Ooh, okay. Now, I think there's no Salt Lake City without Syracuse, but Salt Lake City is the first time I saw machine guns like this tattooed on heads.
That is hard.
I'll tell you a quick story where, I always knew there was always hard straight edge dudes around. In New York, there was always some big meathead straight edge guy down with somebody. So there was always, you know, you always know, you know, a tough guy could come in any form. But we played the first time Madball went to play Salt Lake City, and we don't even get to play. The band right before us goes on. There's a girl fight, and I'm at the merch booth. That's how you know it was a while ago. First of all, I'm at the selling merch. I'm with Bundy, and we see a girl fight, and then right away the people, you know, they're letting the girls fight. These two little white girls, they're going at it, and I'm like, oh shit, fight! Everybody goes at, and then there was cops outside. The cops come running in and they yoke the little girls up. These are straight edge girls, little straight edge hardcore girls. And I saw the cop literally yoke the girl from the back, like, you know, this hard.
Yeah.
And I saw skinny ass spaghetti arms snuffing the police officers.
Wow.
Now, listen, I'm not an anti-cop guy. I got a lot of cop friends, and there's a lot of good cops out there. There's also a lot of pieces about it. There's a lot of good cops. I'm not that. But that day, those pieces of shit deserved it. And I saw those wet noodles, those straight edge wet noodles swinging at these cops. Yo, I bugged out.
I love that.
And this is what's crazy. So I'm like, holy shit, yo, they're punching the cops. It's insane. A riot breaks out. Every cop in Salt Lake City rolls up. I walk out. It's like the Blues Brothers. It's insane.
The Blues Brothers.
Long story, we go in the back. They go, you guys got to get out of here. We don't get to play. We're in the back, and a whole crew of like these straight edge kids, because I see them. They had the machine gun X's, as I say it, tattooed. And they all lit, and they're like, yo, real soft-spoken dudes. You know, like, yo, man, we're really sorry. That sucks, man. We love Madball. This sucks. You guys came in. And I'm like, nah, it's all good. It's all good. And as we're talking, a cop car pulls up and tells them, yo, you guys got to leave. And they turn around. They're like, yo, what the fuck? Get the fuck. We just say later to our fucking favorite. What the fuck? Hey, start flipping on the cops.
Oh,
I fell in love with this. Salt Lake City.
It might be Salt Lake or Syracuse with that.
Listen, I said that. Yeah, I go, dude, that's they motherfuckers are over it. They're over the whole.
Always so good to H2O, man. I had so many. Have so many great shows in Utah, man.
Insane and fucking. But that was great that, you know, like, again, like, you know, and again, you know, Carl, Mad Boy in Syracuse, we had a lot of good vegan meatheads up there. We had a good couple good meatheads. We also lost fucking Syracuse meatheads that were Mad Boy guys.
For sure, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And fucking, that's why I got a special heart. You know, I know Syracuse got that meathead in the water up there. You know what I mean? But
the Hungry Charlie shows, the Lost Horizon shows, and Earth Crisis had awesome concerts out there in Salt Lake. We played with Lifeless, we played with Excessive Force. Like those are bands that are legends. You know, they're gonna live forever, not just there, but around the world, you know.
Oh, yeah, hell yeah. And real quick, I think I'm gonna give you my choice.
I guarantee you met Alex Slack that day.
Yeah,
Alex Slack, the singer of Lifeless. He had to be one of those guys.
Oh, but probably it was amazing. I fell in love. Well, fucking Salt Lake vegan straight edge that day. And so look at how many years ago this was. Oh, 20 something years ago.
Right.
I remember it like fucking yesterday.
Yeah.
But all right. there has to be one band on the straight edge, one hardcore band on the straight edge class that's going to be like, okay, that's the definition of a straight edge band that, okay, you agree that should be in the Webster Dictionary. I say Minor Threat.
Well, of course. I mean, I love Slapshot. I love Youth of Today and Judge. And I have but I mean, this would not exist without Minor Threat and Teen Idols. Yeah. So all credit and glory goes to them for sure.
That's facts.
Who do you think, too. Toby? You, Toby?
Minor Threat, man.
It would have to, I mean, not even your favorite band, but it gotta go.
They're
on
very
there.
Important, but I'm gonna go Judge anyway.
Oh shit, yo, I like that. I like that. You know, against the grid.
It's too early in the sound. Sonically, it's too early.
They got Richie's
it's
hard.
It's like that shaking punk rock. You know what I mean? Like yeah. Judge. You, okay, like you know, Muhammad. Who's the first heavyweight champion? We're gonna say he's the best ever, or we're gonna say Muhammad Ali? Ali.
Yeah, listen. I hear you. Go ahead.
I want to say two things. I'll never forget being watching Judge when they came back. Me and Carl are watching them in some festival in Canada, and Carl says to me, "You know, bringing it down is the Age of Coral, the straight edge Age of Coral."
Wow. Yes.
And that is so fucking perfect. I told Mike that, he was so happy. It's such a perfect review of that record, man.
Yeah, he's
still totally straight edge. He's still the same guy. He's beautiful.
Love
yeah.
Mike Judge.
Yeah, that's good. So I came up with my own while I was doing this thing. So I got Carl. You know, he's the patent of straight edge, right? And Toby, you the David Lee Roth of straight edge, right? And Richie, the Andrew Dice Clay of straight edge. Oh. I got this shit down, dude. Do you understand?
I'm over here now.
Is that because of my high kicks on stage?
Part of the kicks, but you know, I don't know. Hardware job. I think of you like tights. Wow. No, but great entertainer, great classic. That's you.
Patton,
I could see Carl with that helmet. Right now, when we get off this, he puts the helmet on with the stars, the X's, like Patton. And Richie, when we get off the vest comes on and the whole shit.
The only thing is Dice smokes. Richie don't smoke.
Yeah, that's wrong. You got my goal.
I want to say two things. One, the reason that I'm so attracted to hardcore and punk was because it was a melting pot for all types, all walks of life.
Yeah.
It wasn't just, we're all this, so... So that's why
it made it more fun.
People drinking, people straight edge, people punk, Mohawks, skaters, all that. That was my attraction to it, you know. And another thing, I don't know if Richie has the right to ask us if we would sell out straight edge or veganism, because this motherfucker's not even vegan.
Yeah, I love it. Hey, let him know. Hey, I'm glad you brought it up later, but you see, you almost let him get through the whole episode.
Damn. He called me out.
Oh, shit. But that was good.
I was just asking the question. And you know what? The question I gave to Carl was actually in Reading.
Yeah.
I sat down with him out of the couch. I was face to face.
There you go.
That's when it quit. And it was a great response. But Hoya, I know you got to get going. But I tried to get Carl on my podcast many times. He always denies me. But hey, I understand. But can I give him a question that I wanted to ask?
Absolutely.
Wait. Eric. Is this okay that we're doing this?
Yeah.
Okay. We're doing this at Eric's house because I am a caveman and yeah. I don't even own a computer. This is the closest I've gotten to
your technological
world that is, the future to me and your present, you know?
And this is what I wanted to do because I know you're a caveman.
You're
a caveman. And that's why I wanted to be able to get all my friends, cavemen included,
right,
on this to make these Salvador Dali paintings come to life. You know what I mean?
For sure. But Richie, we could do this.
I love that you're off the grid. I fucking have so much respect for that, man. I love that so much. I envy that, dude.
But look,
it's so amazing.
But look, hit him with the question. Then I got one more question, and I'm going to give you guys a quick one, and then we got it. But I want to hear this. Now you got me going. I want to hear this.
Carl is the front man of what I will say is probably one of the most culturally relevant bands ever to come out of hardcore. So his lyrics, the presence, they changed a lot of people's lives. All music does, you know, but his made movements and changed things that would change economics. And
facts.
I think bands like his help develop, like when we're seeing a vegan burger in a fast food place, you know. Anyway,
100.
throughout his time, very militant band. And I love that, even though I don't even dabble in the vegan stuff. I just love the idea of being so extreme and anti, you know, oh, you say do this, I'm going to do that. So there were a lot of things related to Earth Crisis that they would call terrorism.
Right. Like, you know,
and I wonder if he has any regrets of the things of, because people may have committed these things due to his, you know, his influence.
Well, here's what I'll say. Basically, what we did with Earth Crisis lyrically when we started out was we were telling the stories, the true stories of the Animal Liberation Front, people that were breaking into laboratories and rescuing animals that were being experimented on by scientists, cruel experiments, needless experiments. We're telling those stories. We're telling stories about a group called Earth First that had activists that were out trying to save forested mountains where endangered animals were living from being strip mined or have the forest clear cut. And they were using tactics that were destroying machinery or damaging mills. And we also had songs about the sea shepherds trying to stop whaling out in the ocean. And you were not reading about that stuff in Rolling Stone. That stuff was not on TV. There was no whale wars. There was a media blackout on all those types of activism. So some of the songs that we were writing were about things that actually happened, like the raid on the lab in Silver Spring, Maryland, where the monkeys were rescued. They were about specific things. So in a way, we were documenting history that mainstream news media in Hollywood were ignoring. And it felt like they had an order from the top down to not touch on these subjects, to not shine a light on what was happening to the animals in the labs or the whales out in the sea, or, you know, how the mountain lion's habitat was being destroyed by logging corporations. And because we were documenting that history, not through a documentary film, not through a novel, but through the lyrics and through the, you know, the driven by the engine of music, I think we were celebrating those victories, you know. And what do we call ourselves? We call ourselves what we always have, a vegan straight edge band, you know. So we weren't telling people to go out and break the law and get put in prison or something like that. Vegan straight edge. How about looking into veganism? How about separating from, you know, the big pharmaceutical companies and big tobacco and these companies that were marketing alcohol to children with cartoon characters, you know? So that was our goal. And I mean, we've persisted with it. We got a new record coming out this year. And this is basically our 30th anniversary, you know? And in 30 years, I mean, we became friends with guys from, you know, Agnostic Front and from, you know, John Joseph from Cro-Mags with Blood Clot. And, you know, while Rabies was alive, we were his friend. And those were bands we grew up listening to in high school, loving. And we became a part of that world and became friends with those people that we saw as leaders. You know, they weren't heroes to us. They were like leaders. They were showing us a way out of all the chaos. So I have eternal gratitude to all the founding fathers in New York hardcore and DC hardcore and everything that happened in Connecticut and Orange County, you know. And I think more than anything, when you look at the legacy of Earth Crisis, it hopefully helped motivate people to make compassionate choices rather than hurt anyone or get themselves in trouble.
You see, Rich, and all you're worried about is what kind of pepperonis on your pizza.
No, not at all.
This fucking guy is crazy. Doing that, and you're telling me I get my pepperonis the same
place. Racist. But listen, see Carl's response? That's why I love this guy. This guy is as real as it gets.
Right. Toby, facts. Word, I hear you. I'm more like, dude, please pass the jelly. You know, I'm still on that. Well, one last question. Well, go ahead, Toby, hit me.
I was going to say, everything these guys were singing about, it's all happening. It's been happening. And it's so prevalent.
It was prophecy.
Yeah,
those lyrics ring true today. And I would even put Earth Crisis and the Dead Kennedys, where they were talking about all political shit.
Listen,
too.
Listen, fuck like the Dead Kennedys. Fans. Earth Crisis is on that. Yeah, is that
fuck
real?
That
shit?
Earth Crisis.
No, Earth Crisis. No, fuck Dead Kennedys. I'm saying. I know you mean. I know you mean.
You know what I mean? Like just talking about shit that's happening.
No,
now.
Yeah. What I like was exactly they talked about also not just like again, obviously the animals and the plate, but they were talking about the earth and the, you know, the pollution, and that was like, oh, that's an angle that okay, we could get away from at the moment. A hamburger or whatever, and still work on the earth and work on the lifestyle. You got to start somewhere. And that's what I like, that it wasn't just about what you're eating, because it's more than just that. It's that, but it's everything. You got to look. If you can't look at the big picture, you won't get it. And that's what I try to tell people. You can't expect the media to see the big picture. You got to start small and work your way out.
It's right, true. Right. But a lot, they were educating people that you're putting the eating and the environment together. Nobody put those two together. Which
it was way before. I wasn't ready for it to way later. You know what I mean? Putting it together. Same
way
thing.
Ahead
like,
time.
You know, me and you, we're the last things we're worried about is politics. We're worried about hanging out and like, you know, having a good time and laughing. You know, he was taking things more seriously. But okay, we learned because we have a friend like that. And also Carl learned how to have a good time because he knows us. Because you know, Carl was boring till he met Toby and Hoya and Richie.
Yo, you know what? You know how they say music changes lives? Earth Crisis has, I'm going to say it. I think they probably have saved and changed more lives than any other band in the scene.
Definitely a lot.
Humans and animals.
For sure.
Yeah. I said lives.
They saved a lot of animals. A lot of Nikes didn't
incredible.
Get made.
It's incredible. It's incredible.
Crisis. And.
Yeah. Meanwhile, again, Toby loves Nike, though. Right?
Yeah. But he likes the vegan ones. And yes. And again,
Nikes.
Yeah, yes. Exactly. And why shout out to H2O, you know why H2O was our California band. You know what I mean? That was like that was the one. Like they had all this, you know, shout out to Descend, all those bands, but we didn't have those. We had all the meathead bands. So Toby,
we've got Count Time and Powerhouse too, though.
I'm saying Toby, H2O, nobody was like that in New York, doing that melodic kind of that feel. H2O was the only band that I know, you know? So yeah. I was like, that's our fucking, because I always wanted New York to have, you know, like the melodic band, the tough guy band, the metal band, the Krishna band. I want the girl straight band. I want the straight edge band. I want everything, you know, every scene should have that. Like in the old days, you had.
For sure.
You had something for everybody, you know what I
mean? Oh, you know what? We got to shout out Token Entry too, man.
Of course, shout out,
From Beneath the Streets and Jaybird those albums are incredible.
Listen,
masterpieces,
and definitely,
guy is a real singer. Yeah. He can actually sing.
And I got to give, like chunk. Richie was talking, big shout out to Judge, because that was my shit. Where I was like, man, now I can't talk shit on these straight edge motherfuckers as far as musically. You know, I'm like, man, they came with the chops. You know what I mean?
Compared that to Age of Quarrel. In my opinion, it's better than Age of Quarrel.
That's big.
An album. It's very big because I'm a big fan of Age of Quarrel.
I think, but I love what whoever said that's the straight edge Age of Quarrel.
That's Carl. Brilliant. Carl's quote.
I'm going to take it. I'm going to say I did it, everybody. Quick, I copyrighted it. But all right, one last question. I got one last question before I'm going to hit you with a quick little thing.
Wait, we got to say this, though, dude.
Say it.
The crown goes to Conflict, because Conflict is who got all the punk rockers and all the hardcore kids into animal rights.
Oh, they're facts. Punk, the punk band kind
the
of,
The punk
right?
band Conflict from That's England.
Facts. Oh, yep. I did okay. So I, didn't, right. so, I didn't know that.
And they got it. So not only did they influence their own thing, hardcore, I mean, punk rock, but they influenced hardcore, and they might not even know that, but they did.
Yeah. True. He's right.
Yeah. There's one. I want one last thing, and I'm gonna hit you guys with a couple questions. We out here, but there's one thing, the one thing you hate about straight edge, and there's one thing that I hated with straight edge from any era or something. I hated chokers. You straight edge motherfuckers used to wear that shit.
So whack.
I hated chokers. I'm like, you motherfuckers look like, maybe because I had no neck. You know, I got no neck, and I was like, maybe subconsciously hating, but I used to be like, yo, what's up with that shit around your neck? Yo, let that shit hang. You know, I was more like a Rakim, dude. Let that shit hang, a big medallion.
No, it doesn't matter what you guys like. It matters what the straight edge girls like. If they want to see you in that, you got to wear that.
Oh, is that what it is?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
That was big, though. Hoya pointed that out.
Right? I hated it. Okay, that's what I hated about straight edge.
Yeah.
Toby, I'm going to put everybody on the spot. So think, what's something you hated about straight edge? It could be anything. Because you can't be fully happy with your family. If you got family members, you know, are scumbags, you can say something about your scene you're not too hot about. Right? Like chokers, I wasn't crazy about.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't really rock chokers either. I didn't hate them, but I never really rocked something super tight. I had the token entry neck. That's the original they gave me.
The sick of it all one. That was a
and I had the alleyway one too.
Yeah. That looked like a dog. You guys look like fucking dogs. Like, yeah, like a dog thing. Like ASPCA. Collar. Yeah, like exactly like ASPCA. You're fucking.
Oh, no. It's crazy because I liked it. Like, in the GB house, we all cut the sleeves off your shirt and roll them up, and the bottoms too. You roll the bottoms up.
Yeah.
We had the canvas belt. We had like low socks.
But I didn't hate that. I liked it. Oh, you loved it all. You just loved it all.
Let me think. Get back to me.
All right. Richie, what you hate it?
I hated that there was an image with straight edge of almost weakness.
Okay,
some people had this. Some people in the so-called other, you know, the other scenes looked at it as
being soft. Yes.
Soft pussy, blah, blah, blah.
Yep.
So maybe some
I think that's done.
Yeah.
I don't think we have to worry about that anymore.
Yeah. This is when I'm a younger cat, you know.
Yeah,
this
I know what you mean. Yeah, yeah. I would almost overcompensate
back then to prove. I think a lot of areas did.
That's good, because even the choker, I don't even think people rock those anymore, do they?
I hope not.
Right?
No, I don't think so.
That's what I'm saying. So I'm saying from any era, if it was a little thing, even if it was a little trend within straight edge or whatever.
That's what bothered me, that it had that attachment to it for a time being, you know, when I was younger.
Yeah, that's actually
I wanted
good.
To always disprove that, yeah.
I hear you. And you know what? I got to say, for me, two people that made that change, you know, I always, again, New York always had some big meathead straight edge dude down with somebody. If it was Wrecking Machine or whoever back in the day, whatever. But from crowds was meatheads from Syracuse and the Salt Lake City, where you felt a little bit more like, oh no, there's bigger guys, these football player jock dudes that now they're straight edge. They found a new reason to fight, you know. Like,
I like that.
You know what I mean? And
I'm not against that. Yeah, it's not even against it.
It was what it was, you know. And Syracuse had the college guys.
It needed a show of strength.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Kyle, what's yours?
Here's what I hate. I hate when people, if people don't want to be straight edge anymore, that's fine. But when people sell out straight edge and start talking shit on us.
Those fucks.
Yeah, that does get on my nerves a little bit.
That's not so much anymore.
Point. Not so much anymore. But that definitely pissed me off. It's like, wait a second. You guys were writing these songs. People were coming to see you. People were loving this. They thought they were celebrating something together. Then 3 years later in a magazine, running us all down. What the hell is that?
We know, Carl, exactly when, you know.
Who?
You
tell
know,
us
it,
who.
It's just cool that, you know, you're trying to, these guys want to do other bands, and I get it in different scenes, but.
Yeah, but you don't need to run it down.
Yeah, yeah. Exactly. You don't also got to, you know, we got to remember that half the people are there because of who you were.
Yeah.
And so you got to at least show some love and maybe ease them up into it and don't just shit on them for maybe not moving the way you want them to be moving at the moment because they're not transitioning yet. You know what I mean?
For sure. And some people are going to watch this whole thing when you archive this and be like, why do these guys care so much about this? And the reason why, you know, me and Richie and Toby care so much about this is because I guarantee you, when all of us were young, we saw some very bad examples of how substance abuse affected other people beyond just the addict. And that's why we took this stuff so seriously. And that's why we were so passionate about it. Because for me, in some ways, I felt like I was robbed a little bit of my youth. So I tried to hang on to certain aspects of it, and it got mixed together with a little dose of anger. You know what I mean? Yeah. And that's a bizarre thing for somebody to hear. But that's like the reality of my experience. And I think that's part of the reality for a lot of straight edge people. For their background, you know, it's like they took this so seriously because maybe their brother got hit by a drunk driver when he was on a bike. Maybe their mom was buying liquor instead of groceries. You know what I mean? Yeah. Or maybe somebody got hurt at school over shit that was related to drugs. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that is why there is this anger in a lot of people that are drawn to this whole thing and are part of this whole thing for a while they adjust to the reality that, like, okay, well, you know what, that's something terrible that happened, but that person made a bad choice, but that's not the choice that I'm going to make. And I know people that do drink or smoke or, you know, are involved with this or that, and it's fine for them. It doesn't make them dangerous. It doesn't make them destructive. It doesn't make them hostile towards me. That's something that they're doing. Like, and I remember my sister when I was a kid, she's like, you know, oh, you guys were watching a video in the basement and you guys were falling off a railing off your skateboards and laughing at each other when people are hitting the ground. And you're saying that alcohol is bad and you never wear a helmet on your ramp. And I was like, yeah, you know what? That's true. And I was like, yeah, that's true. It's like, I get it. Not everyone's going to think the same way, but not everyone is going to have those same negative experiences and influences on people around them.
Exactly. That's one of the reasons I wanted to do this for the two main reasons. One, again, the importance of this whole the straight edge movement and the hardcore movement, like I've been saying a million times, it's a brick in this fucking house. And it's something that, you know, it's part of, you know, it's one of the, you know, one of the people that live in our house, you know, and this hardcore house is one of the things. And another reason is to show people that everybody is invited if you want to be down and not. And anybody who's telling you I can't be your friend because you're not like this, they don't, you shouldn't be friends with them, and they don't really got your back if they're worried about, you know, how you choose to live your life.
Right. You know what I mean? And think about this too. Like, I play in Apocalypse Tribe. I'm the only straight edge guy in Apocalypse Tribe. Everybody smokes weed and drinks, you know what I mean? But we've all been friends forever. And all the guys that I grew up skating with, like one of my best buddies, JT, he has been smoking cigars since we were 16, and the man is 50.
Yeah, exactly. You know,
I'm the only straight edge guy.
Toby too.
For 26 years.
Yeah, there you go. There you go.
Some guys are sober now. Some guys are less. They're getting older.
Yeah, because when I first met Richie, he was doing just cocaine. He wasn't even doing heroin.
Get out of here.
Oh, shit, my fault. All right,
we got Luke in the band, but I'm throwing him out unless he becomes straight edge.
But listen, all right, listen. No, I'm glad for making it happen. Toby, Carl, Richie, you know what's up.
And wait, Hoya. Yeah. If you got a straight edge tattoo and you sold out, please get rid of it, cover it off. You were never a Marine.
Didn't have that tattoo.
I should have said that right off the bat.
That's it. You called it. But we claim it. Any straight, look, all straight edge from now on, you could go back to this podcast to reference anything. This is the new Bible, the new laws of straight edge on this. But on the real, I love you dudes. I'm glad you were able to do this. I wanted to change it up. I wanted to show love to straight edge. I wanted to show off that, you know, in our world, we have everything and everybody rocks together, and we all get together when we need to be together, when it counts. You know what I mean? Yeah. So we also got to show these motherfuckers, not just talk about it. We got to let them see it. And like we're doing on this by all of us, you know, again, before we get out of here, where could we catch you at, Richie? Or the your podcast and everything, let people know.
Post America Podcast, Wisdom and Chains, and don't forget Crucified Straight Edge merchandise.
Let them know.
You see that picture up there?
Yeah, that's Carlos, let them know.
Much love to all. Thank you, good sir, and good night to all.
And there you go. But can you catch Earth Crisis in a theater near you?
Oh,
We're
gonna be playing with. We're planning to play. I'll say it like that. With Snapcase and Strife, it's the California Takeover. We did part two of it before this whole thing hit.
Great show. Yeah.
Toby was there with his son. And we're gonna hopefully be doing that, some of those with that same package in Philly and Buffalo if everything works out.
Dope. Good shit. Toby, what's up with you? Killing it. The podcast, what else? Let everybody know.
One Life with Gents podcast. You can find me there. H2O's got some shows coming August 7th in Denver. And then we got our New York shows, makeup shows from last year
They're still tickets for that, right? It was sold out. One of the shows, you still had some for the second? Or
yeah,
sold
the 10th, yeah, the 10th is on sale right now. Yeah, at LPR in Manhattan. So I'm excited to get back.
Good shit. Yo, everybody get those tickets. Support all the podcasts. Go to all the shows. Shout out to all you straight edge vegan motherfuckers. And shout out to you, all you non-straight edge vegan motherfuckers. But shout out to Hardcore, the Hardcore family around the world holding it down. I love you motherfuckers. And we out.